Dear students, today we will be discussing power triangle. So power triangle is comprising of active power, reactive power and apparent power. So we will see in detail what these three components are. So before going to the details, we have seen or we have learned power through purely resistive, purely inductive and purely capacitive circuit when AC is applied. Now here you can see that this green signal indicates the power. In a purely resistive circuit, your average power is positive. In a purely inductive circuit, the average power is zero. And in a purely capacitive circuit, the average power is zero. In a purely inductive circuit, you can see that the power is having double the frequency compared to the source voltage, which is given in the orange curve. It is having double frequency and it is oscillating in nature. That is, during one half cycle it is receiving power from the source and the other cycle it is delivering the power back to the source. Similarly, in pure capacitance also, in one cycle it is receiving power from the source and it is delivering the power back to the source. So it is having an oscillatory behavior when it comes to the nature of power. And another thing that you can understand is that there is a phase difference of 180 degree between the power that is being flowing in and that is flowing in purely inductive and purely capacitive circuit. That is, when a purely capacitive circuit absorbs the power, a purely inductive circuit delivers the power. So and the average power is zero. So you have an oscillation of energy between source and the component, the reactive component, that is L or C. Okay, so there is an oscillation of energy between, and hence your average power is zero. Now how will you apply KCL and KVL in AC circuits? You have seen how to apply it in DC circuits. In an AC circuit, you have to follow the vector addition. That is, if you have an AC series R, L and C circuit, VR, VL and VC are the voltage across R, L and C. So your net voltage V will be equivalent to VR plus VL plus VC. Similarly, in a parallel circuit where your current is I, which is divided among IR, IL and IC, your net current will be, or supply current will be IR plus IL plus IC, which is in vectorial form. So you have to keep this in mind while continuing with the lecture. Now we will take an example of a parallel RLC circuit to explain the different components of power. So in this case, you have IR is given as 5 ampere. This is the magnitude of IR, and the magnitude of IL is given as 20 ampere, and the magnitude of IC is given as 10 ampere, which is flowing in this particular circuit. And you must also be remembering that in a purely resistive circuit, current and voltage are in phase. In a purely inductive circuit, the current is lagging behind the voltage by an angle of 90 degree. And in a purely capacitive circuit, the current is leading the voltage by an angle of 90 degree. Since in a parallel RLC circuit, voltage is common for R, L and C, we are considering voltage as a reference. And keeping voltage as a reference, you have IR, IL and IC. So since you have to do the vector addition, you will be getting the resultant of IL and IC as IL minus IC. So vector here, and the resultant of this IL minus IC and IR will be your voltage or the input current, supply current I. So I is given by root of IR square plus IL minus IC the whole square. So you will be getting the value of IS 11.18 amperes, and the power factor is 0.045 lagging, or the power factor angle phi is -63.2, and the negative sign for this particular angle is indicates that it is lagging. That is, you have a reference of voltage and the current, so your current is lagging behind the voltage by an angle of phi. So you are having a negative sign, assuming that you have a direction of rotation in the anticlockwise direction. Now you can think this in this way. That is, you have a 5 ampere current that is being supplied into the resistor, or it is being consumed in the resistor. You have 5 ampere current flowing through the resistor, and you have 20 and 10 ampere flowing respectively through L and C. Now, what will be the power that is consumed in the resistor? Power consumed in the resistor will be depending on the voltage and the current that is flowing in the particular circuit. And the power consumed in the inductor is, pure inductor is zero. Power consumed in the pure capacitor is zero. There will be oscillation of power between the elements, reactive elements, and the source. There is no absorption. It is energy storage element. It will be storing energy. It will be giving it back. So, if you take the circuit as a whole, you can see that the power will be useful only in the case of resistor. That is, useful component will be resistive component. How can you say that the power is useful? See, you have some current flowing through the resistor. The power that is developed will be converted to heat. So that heat is a physical quantity that is that can be sensed, or that is a useful component that is available from the resistor. But in the case of L and C, you don't have any useful component because power is being received and it is being sent back. Now again, in the case of a motor, you will take the case of an example of a motor where your mechanical energy, you will be converting the electrical energy to mechanical energy. So this conversion also occurs, and you will be getting some useful power. So in the case of a bulb, you can convert your electrical energy to light energy. So there also you are having some physical quantity which can be sensed, and these all physical quantities, heat, mechanical output, light, or all are quantifiable values, and these are all useful outputs. So these are all related to the resistive component that is available in the circuit. Now if you say that you have the current that is flowing through the resistor is the only useful component, you should you have the option of supplying only that current. That is, only 5 amperes is required in this whole circuit, and you need to send only 5 amperes. But in this case, this I is equal to 11.18 ampere. But the useful part is only 5 amperes. Rest of the 10 ampere, that is the component of the resultant of 5 and 10 gives, 5 ampere and 10 ampere gives 11.18. The rest of the 10 ampere is not useful. It is just oscillating between this source and the this particular L and C. Now what it implies is that suppose you have a conductor A and B, okay, and you have current flowing between A and B. So you have one case where you need to flow only 5 ampere current, and the other case you need to flow 11.18 ampere. So in the case of 11.18 ampere, what happens? You need to have more area of cross section for the conductor. So you need to have more area of cross section for the conductor to flow 11.18 amperes when compared to 5 ampere. So in place of 5 ampere, useful component is 5 ampere, you are sending 11.18 ampere. So that simply means that you need to have larger wire to pass this current or the power. Now what happens? If I increase my capacitive current IC to 20 amperes, what will happen? My IL and IC balances out. Okay, it will be equal. Now I will be equal to IR. So in this case, I will be equal to 5 amperes. And your power factor is unity, and phi is 0. And in this case, what happens? You'll have the power here. You'll have the power, but that power will be oscillating from L to C and C to L. Because in an inductor, if this is the case for inductor power, this will be the case for capacitor. Okay, once the inductor absorbs the power, capacitor will be delivering, and when capacitor absorbs the power, inductor will be delivering. So the power will be oscillating between these two. Okay, and the power that is supplied from the source will be used, entirely used up in the this resistance. So keeping all these things in mind, we'll go to the further analysis. Now let us assume that your voltage is 100 volt in the previous example. So IR is 5 ampere, IX is 10 ampere, and I is 11.18 ampere. Okay, 11.18 ampere, it is the current. Okay, now I is equal to IR square plus IX squared. Now, if I multiply with V, what you will get? VI is equal to V into I R square plus I X square, which can be written as V I R square plus V into I X squared. Now, V, now here you can see that V into I R, V into I X, and V into I. You have three components coming into this equation. So, this this will be in the form of some power. Okay, some power. This is also another power. This is another power. Now, you can also think of this three components coming together to form a triangle, because this is a Pythagoras triangle, Pythagoras theorem equation. So, some triangle is being formed here. Now, V into IR, you will be getting the value as 500. V into IS, IX is 1000. I will be writing the units soon. And V into I is 1118. Units will be specified. So you have these three values available, and these three values form a triangle. Now, active power is a power that is actually consumed in the circuit, which is also known as real power or true power. It is also known as wattful component, because it delivers some power which can be used. It has watt in it or power in it, and it is able to transfer the power, able to consume the power. So that component is given by V into the in-phase component of current, that is I cos phi, VI cos phi. So VI cos phi can be further simplified as I squared into R. That is, cos phi is R by Z from your impedance triangle, and V by Z can be written as I. So that is I squared R. So you can say that P is the power that is consumed in the resistance I squared R. Now the unit is watts, kilowatts or megawatts, and the notation is capital P. In the case of reactor, it is a power that is developed in reactive elements. You can see that some power is oscillating between reactive elements in one case, and in the other case power is oscillating between source and load, source and these reactive elements. So that power is known as reactive power. Now, that does not do any useful work, it is just oscillating between the elements. So that is the power developed in the reactive elements I squared XL. So that is I squared into XL can be written as Z sin phi, which can be further given as I into Z can be written as V, so VI sin phi. So that is, reactive power will be the quadrature component of applied current into the RMS value of applied voltage. Applied RMS current, and it is a quadrature component of RMS value of applied current and the RMS value of applied voltage. So I sin phi into V gives this Q. Now Q, the notation is Q for reactive power, and it is also known as wattless component because it does not do any useful work, it just oscillates, and it is also known as the reactive component. Now apparent power, which is specified as S, which is a product of RMS value of applied voltage and current, which is given by V into I. Now the unit is volt ampere, KVA, VA or MVA, and it is specified as S is equal to V into I, which can be given as I squared into Z. Now the unit of reactive power, just missed it, it is volt ampere reactive, VAR, volt ampere, you are multiplying with I, VI, and since it is reactive in nature, reactive elements are there, so it is volt ampere reactive and kilovolt ampere reactive or KVAR. Now S is given by V into I, P is VI cos phi or S cos phi, Q is VI sin phi or S sin phi. So from this you can arrive at this triangle. Okay, so this is P, not R. This is P, which is given by I squared R, Q, which is given by I squared XL, and S, which is given by I squared Z. So from this you can form a triangle. So from this triangle you can express power in complex form as, in rectangular form as, S is equal to P plus JQ. Similarly, in the case of, so this circuit is valid in the case of if your elements are reactive elements are reactive in inductive in nature. If your reactive elements the net value is capacitive in nature, you will be going for this particular figure. So that is, Q will be I squared XC, and you will be getting your S, that is apparent power as P minus JQ. Now We have explained this based on parallel circuit, parallel RLC circuit, keeping voltage as a reference. If you take current as a reference for a series RLC circuit, what happens? If I take current as a reference, I can solve this current again into two components, a cos phi component and a sin phi component. So I cos phi into V gives the active power, I sin phi into V gives the reactive power, and the resultant will be the apparent power. So that is also valid. Now, P is V into IR, which is 500 watts. Q, which is V into IX, which is 1000 VAR. S, which is going to be V into I, which is 1118 VA. This is from the example that we have taken. So we have formed that into a triangle. So this is again, this is P, Q and S. So this is the way you can form the power triangle. So remember, you have active power, reactive power and apparent power forming a power triangle. Okay. Active power is a wattful component or the useful component. Reactive power is a wattless component or the reactive component. And the resultant component, which is being supplied from the source, is known as the apparent power. So,